Okay, welcome back, everyone. Welcome to QIP 2017. We're really excited to have John Preskill here to give our final tutorial at QIP 2017. John is going to tell us about quantum information and space-time. I think all of you know John. We probably all read his wonderful lectures on quantum computation and quantum information. Of course, John is the Feynman Professor of Theoretical Physics at Caltech and also founded the Institute for Quantum Information at Caltech, which now is expanded, and he directs the Institute for Quantum Information and Matter there. He's won several teaching awards at Caltech, so this tutorial is sure to be fantastic. We're all sure to learn a lot. He's going to talk about some fundamental results in black holes, quantum gravity. We're going to learn about the new relationships with quantum error correction. So we're all thrilled to have John here to give this final tutorial. Let's welcome John Preskill.
Thanks. Thank you, Krista. Everybody here? I mean, you can hear, right? And thanks for turning out. So I'm a physicist, and I realize that a lot of you consider yourselves to be computer scientists, and that's fine. But as far as I'm concerned, everybody in the room is a physicist. Because whenever we talk about storing information or processing information, we're considering some physical process. Everything we say about information is a statement about physics, either in some fictitious world or in the real world. And the real world is particularly interesting. It's a quantum world, and that's why information is a topic for quantum physics, and you all know that. That's why you're here. But what I've been charged with is to talk about connections between quantum information and high-energy physics. But what is high-energy physics? Like our soon-to-be president of the United States, I'm on Twitter, so I'm accustomed to distilling thoughts down to 140 characters or less. High-energy physics addresses the question, what underlying theory explains the observed elementary particles and their interactions, including gravity? And I find it a little bit harder to distill our field of quantum information science down to a question of 140 or fewer characters. But a lot of what we do addresses, in some way or another, the question, can we control complex quantum systems? And if so, what are the scientific and technological implications? Now, these two questions don't seem to have a whole lot to do with one another, but I insist that they are, in fact, closely related. The way I think we should look at the field of quantum information science is that we are really still in the early stages of the exploration of a new frontier of physical science, what we might call the entanglement frontier or complexity frontier. We are acquiring and perfecting the ability to build and control highly entangled quantum systems, which are so complex that we can't simulate them with our digital computers, and that opens new opportunities for discoveries about nature. This is a frontier quite different from the one we explore in high energy physics at very short distances, but like that one, it's very fundamental and exciting. I think Feynman was on the right track when he presciently stated the manifesto for our field: if you want to make a simulation of nature, you'd better make it quantum mechanical. And I think from a physicist's perspective, what's particularly exciting about quantum computing is that we can anticipate, though we don't really know for sure, that with a quantum computer we will be able to efficiently simulate any process that occurs in nature, and that's going to have big impact on society through new technologies that will arise, but it also means that we'll be able to explore fundamental physics in different ways. Quantum computers will be used to simulate strongly coupled quantum field theories and exotic processes like the quantum behavior of black holes and the early universe right after the Big Bang. And we're seeing an explosion of interest in quantum information ideas from the community of people who work on quantum field theory and quantum gravity. People are interested in entanglement and quantum information processing in this community because they recognize that those concepts are relevant for the questions that they're trying to answer. So I need to explain physics before we can get started. First, over about 20 minutes, I'm going to give some background, and then we'll all be ready to forge ahead. So I want to talk about gravitation, and I want to talk about quantum field theory, and I don't want to assume that you know very much about either topic. General relativity, that's Einstein's theory of gravitation. It was masterfully distilled down to two sentences by John Wheeler. It says that space-time tells matter how to move, matter tells space-time how to curve. Space-time is described by a Riemannian geometry. Objects on which no other forces are acting follow geodesics in that geometry. The space-time has curvature, which is determined by its content of energy momentum, and that is what is encoded in Einstein's gravitational field equation, which I'm not even going to write down because you don't need to know today. Now, in general relativity, we recognize that even empty space with no matter can have energy. We call that the cosmological constant, or sometimes we call it dark energy. And if that energy of empty space is positive, then space-time has positive curvature, and we call the corresponding solution to Einstein's field equations de Sitter space. And when empty space has negative energy, then space-time has negative curvature, and we call that anti-de Sitter space, or ADS for short. Now, de Sitter space and anti-de Sitter space are different in profound ways. De Sitter space doesn't have a boundary. Anti-de Sitter space has a boundary. We'll talk more about that. And that makes doing quantum mechanics in anti-de Sitter space a lot easier than in de Sitter space, because we can take the point of view of observers who live on the boundary of space-time. But you know what? We live in de Sitter space. We have very good evidence that empty space has positive energy. We're in a positively curved space-time. So that's too bad, because that's the harder case. And eventually, because we live in de Sitter space, we're going to have to figure out how to do quantum theory there. But I'm not going to talk about that today, because a lot less is known about it than quantum mechanics in anti-de Sitter space. So we're going to have to be acquainted with the concept of a black hole. A black hole is a really cool object. It's a solution to Einstein's gravitational field equations when there's no matter. It's composed of nothing but pure warped space-time geometry. And the defining feature of a black hole is its event horizon. If you are foolish enough as to venture across the event horizon to the interior of a black hole, then you'll never be able to return to the outside or to communicate to your colleague who remains outside. So to understand the black hole geometry, we use the concept of a light cone. If a flash of light goes off in empty space, a spherical shell expands at light speed. And if we plot that as a function of time, that is the forward light cone of that event in space-time. And the concept of locality or causality in physics says that that event at point P can only influence other events which are in its future light cone. And what one finds by solving the field equations for a black hole is that as you approach its event horizon, the light cones tip inward, so that once you are inside the horizon, the forward light cone takes you only deeper inside the black hole, so that you cannot avoid reaching a singularity at the black hole's interior, where unimaginably strong gravitational forces tear you apart. Pretty cool, huh? Now, that diagram I just showed relativists, that's what we call people who do general relativity, they don't like that diagram. They like this diagram instead, which we call a Penrose diagram after its inventor, Roger Penrose, and this also describes this space-time geometry, but in a way that makes it easier to grasp its causal structure, the structure of its light cones. Each one of the points in this diagram represents a two-sphere, so I'm only indicating a radial direction and a time direction, where time is going vertically upward. And the Penrose diagram has the nice property that all the light cones are tilting 45 degrees away from the vertical, but the diagram makes it very clear that once you are behind the horizon, there's no way that you can avoid traveling into your forward light cone, reaching the singularity inside the black hole. Now, another thing to know about black holes is they really exist. We have lots and lots of astrophysical evidence for that. The most spectacular evidence of all you undoubtedly heard about, a development in physics last year in which two black holes coalesced, each weighing about 30 solar masses, radiated away several solar masses of mass energy in the form of gravitational waves, which we detected on Earth 1.3 billion light years from that coalescence event. That was a great, great technical achievement, and there's really no other sensible interpretation other than a collision of black holes. Now, we're also going to have to talk about quantum field theory. So what is that? It is a quantum theory which, like other quantum theories, has a Hamiltonian. What's unusual about it is that formally it has an infinite number of degrees of freedom in any arbitrarily small volume. And you probably know to be suspicious when people start talking about infinity, so maybe you think it's unlikely that that's really true, and you're right, it's not true. There really is some kind of physics cutoff on very short distances, so we don't really have an infinite number of degrees of freedom in a small volume, but in quantum field theory, which is a mathematically well-defined subject, we envision that we do. And so I'd like you to think about the field theory this way. Let's suppose we, like in the spin systems Norbert was talking about, let's suppose we define the theory on the lattice, and there's something like a harmonic oscillator degree of freedom living at each of the lattice points, let's say in a square lattice in three spatial dimensions. And our Hamiltonian is geometrically local, meaning that only the degrees of freedom at neighboring lattice sites are coupled to one another. But what we're interested in is what the physics looks like when we consider distances that are extremely large compared to the lattice spacing. We call that the continuum limit. You can think about it conversely as we keep some physics distance scale fixed, and then we let the lattice spacing in those physical units get as small as you please. And it's a non-trivial thing that this limit actually exists. Sometimes it doesn't. Sometimes what happens is we get a very uninteresting theory in the limit. It becomes a free theory with no interactions. But in other cases, the limit does exist, and we get an interacting theory which is interesting and actually has applications to the particle physics that we study in the lab. Now, you might think that this long distance theory, which is what we're really interested in, depends in a very complicated way on the Hamiltonian that we use to describe the dynamics of the theory at the short distance scale of the lattice spacing. But actually, something quite wonderful happens, that all of that short distance physics, which might be very complicated, can be encoded in just a small number of relevant parameters, which are all we need to describe the long-distance physics to very good accuracy. That's called universality. Universality means that we can have many different microscopic theories, but they all describe essentially the same long-distance physics. And we'll be particularly interested in quantum field theories in a continuum limit, which are relativistic. Relativistic means that the laws of physics look invariant, look the same to observers who are moving at constant velocity with respect to one another. And that's not actually a property that we have at the lattice spacing level. When we look at the regulated theory, we call it, because we avoid the infinities by introducing the lattice spacing, there's a preferred frame in which the lattice is at rest. That's part of the reason we like to think about this continuum limit, where these space-time symmetries like Lorentz invariants or Boost invariants can apply. So it's really universality that makes physics possible. If we had to understand everything at the scale of 10 to the minus 33 centimeters, the scale where we think quantum gravity has important effects, in order to find the theory of the hydrogen atom, we'd be in really big trouble. That would be extremely hard to do, but fortunately we don't have to do that. Because of universality, all the details of physics at 10 to the minus 33 centimeters, or nearly all the details, can be forgotten for the purpose of describing long-distance physics. So one way of thinking about it is that even if we take literally the idea that there are an infinite number of degrees of freedom, they correspond to shorter and shorter and shorter wavelengths, and in low-energy processes, we can't excite those extremely short wavelength degrees of freedom, so we don't have to worry about them, and we can use a theory in which we ignore that short-distance physics. Now, there's two sides to that story. You might be interested in learning about the very short-distance physics. That's our goal in particle theory, and it's very hard to do. It's hard to learn about physics at 10 to the minus 33 centimeters if you're doing a experiment at the paltry energies that we can achieve at a place like the Large Hadron Collider. Because the low-energy physics is insensitive to the microscopic physics, it's hard to learn about that microscopic physics, which is kind of frustrating. So we use quantum field theory. That's why it's an important subject. We use it to describe the properties of elementary particles very successfully. We have a standard model of particle physics, which has been unchallenged by experimental data going back for decades now. But we don't think that's the end of the story. We call it an effective field theory. What we mean is that it works at the energies that we are currently able to explore experimentally, but we can anticipate that that theory will break down when we go to sufficiently short distances. And this has happened many times in the history of physics, where, for example, we anticipated that our theory of the weak interactions was going to have to be replaced by a new one where there were W and Z bosons and a Higgs boson, which were eventually found experimentally. So another way of saying this is we want to get a certain description of the physics at long distances, and unless we choose the right theory at much shorter distances, we won't get the physics we want at long distances. And choosing that right theory at short distances is what we call finding the ultraviolet completion of the theory, a way to extend it to even shorter distances than the ones to which it was originally intended to apply. Now, you should know these words, infrared and ultraviolet, because I'm going to use them. Physicists mean by infrared, long distance. They use ultraviolet to mean short distance, just like infrared light has a long wavelength, and ultraviolet light has a short wavelength. And the effective theory that we use depends on the distance scale that we're interested in. As we change the distance scale we're probing in order to have an accurate description, we have to change the theory. The way the effective theory changes when we change the scale, we call that renormalization group flow. So when we speak of the ultraviolet theory, we mean the theory that is applicable for physics at very short distance. The infrared theory is the theory that's applicable when we're interested in very long distances. And as I guess I already said, if we have a theory that works at a given distance scale and we want to extend it to even shorter distance scales, we call that the ultraviolet completion of the theory. Okay, so quantum gravity is something we want to understand. We have an effective theory, which is a quantum field theory for all the rest of particle physics. We have Einstein's theory of gravitation. We want to combine these two together in a way which can be completed in the ultraviolet. What's the way to do that? We don't know. That's the problem of quantum gravity. We do know that if we just take the theory that we have and try to extend it to shorter and shorter distances, it's eventually going to break down. We're going to need new degrees of freedom to find an ultraviolet completion. And there's a candidate for how to do that. We call it string theory or M theory. It has many beautiful features. There's a lot about it we don't understand. As far as we can tell, it's mathematically consistent, but we're not really sure whether it describes nature at those very short distances. Now, it's quite different in its status than quantum field theory. There's a lot we don't know about quantum field theory, but at least we can give it an axiomatic framework. We can prove theorems about it. We can do mathematical physics of quantum field theory. We don't really know how to do that for string theory. We don't understand it well enough to state axioms of string theory and prove theorems about them. But we want a quantum theory of gravity. And why do we want that? We just want it, okay? We'd like to have a theory which is a complete theory of nature, which encompasses gravity at arbitrarily short distances, but we also anticipate that this theory will help us to resolve deep puzzles that we've encountered in trying to understand properties of black holes, and we also think this theory can help us to understand the very early history of the universe, the origin of the universe in the Big Bang. Now, we've been able to learn about particle physics and find the effective theory, the standard model, by doing experiments. That's very hard to do with gravity, though, because we have to explore physics at very short distance, which seem to be inaccessible with experiments that we can foresee. So we're trying to figure out what the theory is, and we're trying to figure it out what its predictions are, but without much guidance from experiment, and that's hard to do. Will we be able to figure it out? Humans didn't evolve for this purpose, for the purpose of understanding quantum gravity. Maybe it's just beyond us, but who knows? I don't know whether we can figure it out, so we should try. Why not? Now, in particle physics, we learn about physics at shorter and shorter distances by banging particles together at higher and higher energy. In effect, we're operating a microscope that resolves space at shorter and shorter distances. But when we bring gravity into the story, it can't work like that at arbitrarily short distance. And the reason is black holes. If we bang together particles at sufficiently high energy, eventually we'll be able to make black holes. And if we bang them together at even higher energy, we'll make a heavier black hole, which is a larger black hole. So then we're probing larger and larger distances instead of shorter and shorter ones. So there's a distance scale, essentially the size of the smallest black hole that we call the Planck scale. It's the length scale we can make out of the fundamental constants, Planck's constant, Newton's gravitational constant, and the speed of light. And it's extremely short. That's where that 10 to the minus 33 centimeters came from that I spoke of earlier. And so if we try to probe physics at scales less than 10 to the minus 33 centimeters, it just doesn't work, because when we bang particles together at sufficiently high energy, we just make bigger and bigger black holes. In fact, it's not clear that it makes sense to speak of the geometry of space or of time below the Planck scale, at distances less than 10 to the minus 33 centimeters, or times with duration less than 10 to the minus 43 seconds, the Planck length divided by the speed of light. Maybe space-time is just an approximate emergent concept. There's some underlying deeper theory, and space-time arises as some approximation or low-energy limit of it. That's possible, and maybe we'll be able to figure that out. One more thing about field theory. We should know the idea of a conformal field theory. A conformal field theory is a theory that doesn't have any intrinsic length scale. So in particular, it can't have any massive particles because the mass of a particle would define a scale. And we're especially interested in particle physics in conformal field theories that are also Lorentz invariant, so what we call relativistic quantum field theories, which have no intrinsic scale. Now, in this case, the renormalization group flow is trivial because the theory has no scale. If I change the scale at which I'm looking at the physics, that doesn't change the theory because the physics is scale invariant. So we say the conformal field theory is a renormalization group fixed point. It doesn't change under renormalization group flow. And so it's already ultraviolet complete. It makes sense at arbitrarily short distances because when you go to shorter and shorter distances, nothing happens. There's a parameter in a conformal field theory. We call it the central charge, and it essentially counts the number of degrees of freedom. So if you imagine, say, n uncoupled fields, scalar fields, the central charge would just be the number of fields. But conformal field theories can be more interesting than that. They can be interacting. And you can think of this central charge as counting the interacting degrees of freedom, which interact in a way which is not geometrically local, the number of degrees of freedom sitting at a single site of our lattice regularization of the theory. And one other thing I want you to know about conformal field theories, which we've known for a while, in two space-time dimensions, one space, one time, if we consider a theory which looks like a conformal field theory in the ultraviolet and looks like a conformal field theory in the infrared, if it flows, in other words, from one ultraviolet fixed point to an infrared fixed point, the central charge cannot increase under that flow. The infrared theory can't have a larger central charge than the ultraviolet theory. That's called the C theorem. And it's saying that the number of effective degrees of freedom locally can't increase under renormalization group flow. All right, I was supposed to talk about quantum information. Now you know as much physics as I do. And what I want to talk about is quantum entanglement in quantum field theory. But I'm going to sneak up on that subject in kind of an unexpected way by considering physics as seen by an observer in space-time who has uniform proper acceleration, somebody who's riding a rocket who keeps getting boosted, going faster and faster and faster. Now, let's see what that observer sees when she looks at the vacuum state of a quantum field theory, a relativistic quantum field theory. Well, the vacuum is the vacuum. There's nothing in the vacuum. There are no particles. There's nothing there. Any observer moving at constant velocity will agree that there are no particles. If you carry a particle detector, you don't detect anything. But if you're uniformly accelerated, then you do detect particles. And you can think about that this way. If you follow the trajectory in space-time of this uniformly accelerated observer shown here in blue, that observer is isolated from anything that happens on the left side of this space-time, because no signal from the left side will ever catch up with that uniformly accelerated observer. So anything that that observer can measure is a property of the marginal state of the quantum field theory if I trace the left side out. The vacuum is a pure state, but when I trace out the left side, for the right side, I get a mixed state. And that mixed state has particles which we can detect. In fact, those particles have a temperature. There's a characteristic temperature to what the uniformly accelerated observer sees. Well, here's one way of understanding that, which is that if you parameterize the world line of this uniformly accelerated observer as a function of proper time, you get these hyperbolic trigonometric functions, which have the property of being periodic in imaginary time with period 2 pi over a, where a is the proper acceleration. And periodicity in imaginary time, that's the characteristic feature of thermal fluctuations. That's true because of the formal correspondence between the Schrödinger time evolution operator of quantum mechanics and the Boltzmann factor of statistical physics. So the vacuum fluctuations, no particles, seen by inertial observers look like fluctuations which are periodic in imaginary time with period 2 pi over acceleration to the uniformly accelerated observer. So there's a temperature. And so far I've been forgetting about the fundamental constants h bar and c, but it's important to put them in because you might be wondering, when you floor the accelerator of your Maserati, why aren't your eyes flooded by the thermal bath of photons? And the answer is that if the acceleration is something like 1g, where g is the Earth's gravitational acceleration, the temperature is about 10 to the minus 20k. That's really cold. The characteristic wavelength of this radiation is about the distance you would have to travel in order to be accelerated to a relativistic speed comparable to the speed of light. So now let's think about quantum entanglement in a conformal field theory. Remember, it has no intrinsic scale. And so I can look at some interval. Let's say it's a one-space, one-time dimensional conformal field theory, and look at some interval of length r. And I'd like to know, in the vacuum state, how entangled is that interval with its complement? In other words, I can consider the density operator, the marginal density operator for region r with its complement traced out, and then I compute the von Neumann entropy, that's the entanglement entropy of R with its complement in this pure state, the vacuum state. And because there's no characteristic scale in the conformal field theory, each decade of scale of length contributes with an equal amount to that entanglement. And so when I integrate over wavelength scales, I get a logarithmically divergent integral that gets cut off at long distances by the size of the region. The fluctuations which have wavelength large compared to the size of the region don't contribute to the entanglement between the inside and the outside, and it gets cut off at short distances by whatever our ultraviolet regulator is, like that lattice spacing I spoke of. And so you get a logarithm of the size of the region in units of that ultraviolet cutoff, and the entanglement entropy is also proportional to the number of degrees of freedom, the central charge, and you have to do a real calculation, which I haven't told you how to do, to get this factor of 1/3. So the entanglement entropy is actually infinite. That's not a big surprise because it's a quantum field theory and you have fluctuations of all scale of length and they all contribute to the entanglement, and when you add them all up, you get an infinity. But there are finite quantities we can extract from this calculation. We could differentiate the entanglement entropy with respect to the size of the region, or we could compare entanglement of different regions, or we can compare entanglement in different quantum states and get finite answers. Now, let's come back to the C theorem, because it turns out there's a very nice way to understand it from the perspective of quantum information. So, what do we know about entropy? We know that it obeys subadditivity and it obeys strong subadditivity. Strong subadditivity, you can say, is the statement that if I consider the mutual information of A with another region, that that's greater than or equal to the mutual information of A with a subregion. So for three regions, A, B, and C, that becomes this inequality. And suppose I apply that to the entanglement entropy, where region B is some interval of finite length ranging from x1 to x2 in a one-dimensional, one-spatial dimension field theory. And then I consider system A to be a little increment added on the left side and C a little increment added on the right side. And then I can write down what the strong subadditivity inequality says. Treating these quantities as infinitesimal, I can expand in those quantities. The linear terms cancel, but there's a quadratic term. So strong subadditivity says that the entanglement in the interval going from x1 to x2 when twice differentiated, once with respect to the left endpoint, once with respect to the right, is less than or equal to zero. Now I want another ingredient, which is Lorentz invariant. I'm talking about a Lorentz invariant conformal field theory, and that means that the entanglement entropy should depend on an invariant length of the interval, a length that all observers moving inertially with respect to one another agree on. That invariant length, if x is the difference in spatial displacement and t is the time difference between the endpoints, is the square root of x squared minus t squared. It's convenient to express that in terms of null or light-like coordinates, coordinates u and v, which have the property that either u or v is constant for an object which is moving at light speed either to the left or to the right, and then it's just the square root with a minus sign of uv. So now we put these things together, we can consider adding to the interval at both sides in a null direction, which is just the limit of extending the integral in some space-like direction. And then our strong subadditivity inequality says that if I differentiate with respect to u on the right and left endpoint of the entropy, then that's going to be less than or equal to zero. And that entropy has to be a function of this observer independent length of the interval, and then you just do the little calculation and you get a result which says that if I take the first derivative times r and then I differentiate again of this function of the length of the interval, the invariant length of the interval, then we're going to get a result which is less than or equal to zero. I put this factor of 3 in for the following reason. If I consider a conformal field theory where we know the entanglement goes like log r over the spacing. See, when we differentiate, we get a finite quantity, and when I multiply by r, then I just get the central charge if I multiply by 3 as well. So this quantity, which I called C of r, really is C, the central charge for the conformal field theory. And now suppose I consider a theory which flows from an ultraviolet conformal field theory to an infrared one. Then when I'm looking at the entanglement entropy for very short distance intervals, then I use the ultraviolet theory. For very long distances, I use the infrared theory. And what this inequality says is that the infrared theory's central charge can't be larger than the central charge of the ultraviolet theory. That's the C theorem. And it was very striking when Huerta and Cassini came up with this argument in 2004. Earlier arguments for the C theorem used completely different ideas, so this was a wake-up call that if you're a field theorist, you should know about strong subadditivity. And I'll just comment in passing that these ideas have been taken a little further more recently. There's a recent paper by Cassini and collaborators in which they relate the flow or the change in the central charge to distinguishability of states as measured by relative entropy. So you know, I can use relative entropy as a measure of the distinguishability of two quantum states, and it has to be non-negative. And it also has the property of being monotonic, so that if I apply some channel to rho and sigma, that can only make them harder to distinguish. And by an argument which I'm not going to explain to you, Cassini et al. Gave a description of the relative entropy of two states, one of which is the vacuum state at an ultraviolet fixed point. The other is a vacuum state of a theory which approaches that ultraviolet fixed point at very short distances and then flows away to another conformal field theory with a different value of C. And so this is the formula, and what it says is that if, as we change our renormalization scale, so we're losing information, we're in effect tracing out short distance degrees of freedom, then distinguishability should go down between these two states. And in order for that to be true, as this renormalization mass scale decreases, then the difference of the central charges has to be positive. So that's another way of getting at the C theorem, but it's a little bit sharper because it relates the change in C along the flow to a measure of distinguishability. Now, you can ask about C theorems in higher dimensions, and you can use the same kind of argument I used before to see how that's going to go. If I have a ball of radius r in d spatial dimensions, then the entanglement between the inside and the outside can be obtained, again, by integrating over fluctuations of all scale of length, but that is now controlled by the radius of the ball. And because we get a contribution that scales like the total boundary volume of the ball, it goes like the radius of the ball to the d minus 1 power in d spatial dimensions. But to make the entropy dimensionless, that means we get lots of powers of the lattice spacing in the denominator when we're in more than one spatial dimension. And that makes the formula not very interesting because the number in front depends on the details of how we cut off the theory at very short distances. We say that's a non-universal number. But you can still say something interesting if you expand the entropy in powers of the lattice spacing divided by the size of the ball. So in two spatial dimensions, there's an additive correction, which is just a constant independent of the size. In three spatial dimensions, there's an extra logarithmic correction, and those are universal. They really do mean something. And there are recent theorems that say that both F and A also are monotonically decreasing along renormalization group flow. And in the case of F, there is a recent success in understanding the monotonicity of F from the point of view of entropy inequalities, but so far no such result for A, though it should be possible to find one. Now, a thing we talk about a lot in discussing entanglement in quantum field theory is called the modular Hamiltonian. It's the same thing that Norbert called the entanglement Hamiltonian this morning. For any density operator, we can take its logarithm, can't we? So we can think of it as being like the Gibbs state with some canonically normalized temperature of some Hamiltonian, which is just the log of the density operator. And that Hamiltonian doesn't necessarily have any clear physical interpretation, but in some cases, it does. So in particular, if I'm considering, I don't think I said it's called Rindler space, but spacetime as seen by the uniformly accelerated observer, the uniformly accelerated observer sees a Gibbs state at some characteristic temperature depending on the acceleration. And so you can interpret the Hamiltonian of the density operator that observer sees as the Hamiltonian which generates time evolution as seen by the Rindler observer, but that's Lorentz boost, because the observer is, as time goes by, the time slices are tilting, as shown here on the right, filling up this right wedge of the space-time. So this is really the Hamiltonian that generates evolution as seen by the accelerated observer, and if we extend those time slices backward, by the way, if they're going forward in time on the right side of the space-time, they're going backward in time on the left side. Now remember something we know about relative entropy. We know it's non-negative. And suppose I consider for some excited state in a conformal field theory, or in other field theories, in some region, like a ball, the marginal density operator rho is the excited state, and rho naught is the corresponding marginal state for the same region in the ground state. Well, then I can write the positivity of relative entropy in terms of the modular Hamiltonian, and it becomes this inequality, that the difference in entropy for the excited state and the ground state is bounded above by the difference in energy as measured by the expectation value of the modular Hamiltonian of the two states on the right-hand side. And in fact, if I consider a state which is close to the ground state, if I just tweak it a little bit and expand to first order in the difference between the two density operators, then the difference in the entropy is just given by this expectation value of energy difference as measured by the modular Hamiltonian. So this has been called the first law of entanglement entropy because of its resemblance to the first law of thermodynamics, which relates change in entropy to change in entropy to first order. Now, this idea of relative entropy came up in quantum field theory about 9 years ago to resolve an old puzzle. Bekenstein had made the suggestion some years earlier that there should be a limit on how much information you can store in a region of space-time if you have only a bounded amount of energy. Now, this is a statement about quantum field theory. It doesn't have anything to do with gravity. But the idea is that if you want to store information, you have to store it in the degrees of freedom of the field theory. And in principle, you have all these short distance degrees of freedom you could use, but they cost a lot of energy to excite. So if you only have a certain amount of energy, there's a limit to how much information you can store. And so Bekenstein conjectured that there would be an inequality like this, saying that the entropy in a region could be bounded by the energy contained in the region times the size, the linear size of the region, let's say, a ball. And that was immediately criticized on several grounds. One is that the entropy is ultraviolet divergence. So what exactly does it mean to have such an inequality? And what Cassini suggested in 2008 is, well, the right entropy to talk about is the difference between the entropy in the excited state and the entropy in the ground state. They're both infinite, but the infinities cancel, because the infinity comes from these very short degrees of freedom that don't care about how we've excited the state right at the boundary of the ball. And now we have this interesting inequality, which is nothing but the non-negativity of relative entropy, which says that the difference in entropy for the two states is bounded by the difference in energy as measured by the modular Hamiltonian. And in the case of a ball in a conformal field theory or in Rindler spacetime, we really know enough about this modular Hamiltonian for this to be a useful inequality. Because remember, in the Rindler wedge, the Hamiltonian is generating boosts, and we know from the connections between symmetries and conservation laws how to write that down as an operator. The Hamiltonian of the usual kind, which advances time, is the integral of some Hamiltonian density, and if we want to find the generator of boosts instead, we just weight that density by something that depends on position. So this is something which has the right interpretation. You can think of it as a size times an energy. That's what really belongs on the right-hand side of Bekenstein's inequality. And in using the entanglement first law, we can say something more specific in the case of states which are close to the ground state. But there was another complaint about Bekenstein's bound, which is it can't possibly be true as a universal statement about quantum field theory, because what's to prevent us from considering a theory with a huge number of different field species? If we have many field flavors, then we can store information in the choice of flavor what color particles or flavor particles we put inside the region encodes information without much energy cost, and I get more and more information if I keep pumping up the number of different species. But what Cassini realized is that this formula still holds. What happens is as you increase the number of species, that increases the entropy of your excited state, but it also increases the entropy of the ground state. And so you actually lose distinguishability eventually as you increase the number of species. This inequality is always positive, or always satisfied, because of course it is. It's just the non-negativity of relative entropy. But it comes closer and closer to being saturated as you increase the number of species, but it's never violated. So this was the wake-up call in 2008, that if you're a field theorist, you should know about relative entropy. So in the rest of the time before the break, I want to talk about black holes and their quantum properties. I told you a little bit about black holes from a classical point of view. We have to talk about these because it is the origin of one of the deepest puzzles in physics. We don't really understand the interior of black holes, and that is a problem having to do with quantum information. It's about entanglement. It arises because of the entanglement between the interior and the exterior of a black hole. So you probably heard the cartoon that black holes, although classically nothing can escape from them, quantumly they emit radiation. You can think of that because there are fluctuations in the vacuum where particles are being continually produced and then re-annihilate, and sometimes one member of a pair of particles gets lost behind the horizon of a black hole, and the other one can escape to infinity, carrying away a positive amount of energy. There's another way of looking at this which builds on our observation about the uniformly accelerated observer, which is, let's suppose that you're trying to lower yourself quasi-statically closer and closer and closer to the horizon of a black hole. As you do so, in order to prevent yourself from falling through the horizon, you have to pump up the thrust of your rocket engine so you have higher and higher and higher proper acceleration. When you get very, very close to the horizon, your proper acceleration has to be very large for you to stay stuck that proper distance away from the horizon. So you're uniformly accelerated. You're seeing a state in which freely falling observers don't see any particles, so you see particles. You see a radiation bath. And most of those particles, as they try to escape from the black hole, they just fall back in. But a few which are directed nearly radially outward are able to escape. They leak away from this black hole thermal atmosphere, carrying away some energy. And we can compute that energy by putting together two things. One is the relationship between uniform acceleration and temperature that we already discussed, and the other is the redshift that quanta experience as they pull away from the black hole, and that's how Hawking is able to calculate a temperature of a black hole. It corresponds to a thermal wavelength which scales like 1/1 the black hole's size. Now, once you know the temperature and how that's related to the energy or the mass, you can find entropy. You just have to integrate the first law of thermodynamics, TdS equals E. Since you know how energy depends on temperature, that allows you to find the entropy, and you get a very interesting answer that the entropy is proportional to the area of the black hole's event horizon, and the units are the Planck units of area, which, remember, are extremely tiny, and that means that the entropy of a black hole is enormous. The entropy of the sun is pretty big. It's about 10 to the 57, but if you had a solar mass black hole, the entropy would be larger by another 20 orders of magnitude. So we know something really interesting about black holes. On the one hand, they're really, really simple. We say they have no hair. They're just solutions to Einstein's equations classically. But quantumly, they're extremely complex if we regard that entropy as counting the number of microscopic degrees of freedom that a black hole can carry. So now, following Hawking, we can imagine preparing some pure quantum state, allowing it to gravitationally collapse, and then it starts to emit Hawking radiation. Eventually it irradiates away all of its mass and it disappears. And then we can ask what happened to the information that fell into the black hole. Did it disappear completely from the universe, never to be recovered? Well, if that's true, that would mean we'd have to give up on the idea that quantum physics is microscopically reversible, described by unitary dynamics. But on the other hand, how can it get out? In order to escape from the interior, we would have to give up on causality in some sense, allowing the information to travel from inside the black hole, in effect going faster than light, to the outside. So there's a quantum information way of thinking about what the puzzle is, which is to relate it to the no-cloning theorem. Because of the deformed geometry of a black hole, it's possible to draw a time slice through the black hole geometry that crosses most of the Hawking radiation it emits during its lifetime and also crosses the collapsing body from which the black hole formed. So if the quantum information winds up being encoded in some very scrambled form in the outgoing Hawking radiation, that means the same quantum information is in two places at once, and the black hole has acted as a quantum cloning machine. It's cloned an unknown quantum state. We know that's incompatible with the linearity of quantum theory, so we're really stuck. We either have to give up on microscopic reversibility or allow cloning, and either way, we seem to have to recast the foundations of quantum theory. So this is what that picture looks like, the way a relativist would prefer to draw it in a Penrose diagram. Here is the space-like slice through the geometry, here's the collapsing body, and here is where most of the Hawking radiation crosses the slice. Now, struggling with this problem some years ago, we came up with the idea of black hole complementarity, which asserts that for reasons that a complete theory of quantum gravity would have to explain, it's not right to think of the inside and the outside of a black hole as two different subsystems of a composite system. Rather, we should think of the inside and the outside as two complementary ways of looking at the same system. One description is appropriate for the observer who falls through the horizon, that's the inside view. The other is appropriate for the observer who stays outside, the outside view. It's hard to reconcile the two, but they're not really looking at two different systems, so we don't have quantum information in two places, just two ways of describing the same Hawking, or the same quantum information. And that idea of black hole complementarity, well, evidence seemed to accumulate over time that it was on the right track, but it was challenged a few years ago by the group known as AMPS. And the way AMPS put it is they said, well, with black hole complementarity, we're trying to reconcile three ideas, each of which on its own seems reasonable. One is that black holes don't destroy quantum information, but they just scramble it up in a form which is hard to read when it leaks out in the Hawking radiation. Another is an observer who falls through a black hole doesn't notice anything unusual at the moment of horizon crossing, though later on that observer will be torn apart at the singularity. And the third is that the observer doesn't see anything unusual outside the black hole, no violations of local quantum physics. And they said we can't easily put these three ideas together. They advocated relaxing the second idea, saying that an observer who tries to enter a black hole would not pass through unscathed, but would be immediately destroyed at a highly energetic firewall right at the moment of horizon crossing. Which is crazy, because that's not at all what is predicted by Einstein's classical field equations, which say that the horizon is smooth. And why would these really, really smart people say such a dumb thing? It's because of the principle of monogamy of entanglement, which we heard about earlier today, and which is very fundamental in our subject. Because they understood that if the horizon looks smooth, that's because there's entanglement, as there is in the vacuum, between the inside of a black hole and the outside. Modes of Hawking radiation that are escaping today are entangled with modes which are behind the horizon. That's why there is Hawking radiation. If information leaks out of a black hole, then eventually the state has to be pure when the evaporation is over, which means that the radiation that comes out at first is in a highly mixed state, but that has to eventually be purified by later radiation. So these radiation modes eventually have to be highly entangled with modes which were emitted from the black hole earlier, and if the laws of quantum physics outside the horizon are what we expect in order to be entangled later on, they better be entangled right at the moment that system B escapes from the black hole horizon. So now system B, this recently emitted Hawking radiation, has a very good reason to be highly entangled with A behind the horizon and C far outside the black hole, and it just can't have it both ways because that would violate monogamy of entanglement. And what AMPS says is we can relax the tension by breaking the entanglement between A and B, but that would make the black hole horizon into a very highly energetic place, a firewall. So what was surprising to me about this experiment that AMPS described is it seemed impossible in principle for a single observer who crosses the horizon to have access to the information that system B is entangled with C and also entangled with A. So the violation of monogamy of entanglement really seemed to make sense operationally. So here we are. Decades of study of quantum gravity, and we can answer this very basic, simple question. What's inside a black hole? What are the possible answers? Well, one is that information is lost, and then there'd be no limit to how much information you could put inside a black hole. You could just keep feeding it stuff forever, and that information would never come back. The AMP's answer initially was there's nothing at all. There is no black hole interior. The event horizon is actually the end of the space-time. That's where the singularity is. Again, that's not at all what we see classically when we solve Einstein's equations. A third possible answer is that black hole complementarity can survive, but it is more wildly non-local than we may have originally imagined, that the interior of the black hole is actually made up of the same stuff which was radiated away by the black hole a long time ago. There's no violation of monogamy and entanglement. B is entangled with A and also with C, but that's because C and A are just different descriptions of the same thing, but that's pretty crazy because it says the interior of the black hole is made of stuff which was radiated eons ago, and is now far, far away. Or maybe we're just completely confused and we got to start over. So where do we go? Well, we have one other development which has been occurring in parallel to much of what I've just been describing. I think Steve Flamia said yesterday that one of the great advances in physics in the second half of the 20th century was the theory of scalable quantum computing. Another one of the great advances was this idea of holographic duality in quantum gravity, originally proposed by Maldacena in 1997. And this gives a picture of black hole physics, which suggests that information really is restored in the Hawking radiation when the black hole evaporates. And the second half of the course will be to elaborate this idea of holographic duality. But the short answer is that Maldacena was able to consider putting a black hole in a bottle. That bottle is a conformal field theory on the boundary of an anti-de Sitter space. And we can imagine inside this bottle making a black hole from gravitational collapse and letting it evaporate and eventually disappear. But there's a dual description of that same physics, which is just a description entirely on the boundary, governed by some conformal field theory. And since on the boundary there's no gravity, there's no black hole, there's no place for information to hide, it seems like there's no possibility of loss of information. And so this is the place where we understand quantum gravity the best, and we can see that black holes do not destroy information, but it leaves us deeply dissatisfied in many ways. It doesn't really explain how the information gets out, and it's not even clear how the physics on the boundary encodes the experience of an observer who crosses the black hole horizon and visits the interior. So that's the end of the first half, and we'll pick it up after the break to discuss in more depth this idea of holographic duality, and that's where quantum information really has great potential to lead to big advances in our understanding of gravitation. Okay.
Great. Thank you, John. Are there any questions? We could take two or three questions before the break, before we grab coffee. Great, right here.
Hi. Perhaps this question is a little premature or will be answered or addressed in the second lecture, but is there any potential for these sort of acoustic black hole analog experiments to shed light on the information paradox?
Yeah, so the question was about experiments which have been done. There are several quite recently which study acoustic analogs of black holes. You can consider, for example, a superfluid flow with a drain so that the flow is faster than the speed of sound in the fluid, and there's an analog of Hawking radiation that can be emitted. So can we learn something about quantum gravity from such experiments? I'm deeply skeptical that we can. But I think they might, they're interesting experiments just the same. And one thing that they might give us some insight to is the extent to which the behavior of these acoustic black hole analogs are sensitive to the short distance physics. Because the Hawking radiation, in a way, takes very short distance physics and blows it up to large scale, which is not what we usually see in physics. So I think it's an interesting phenomenon to study, but I really would be surprised if it helps us understand quantum gravity. Steve.
What would be so bad about microscopic irreversibility? Is that really so bad?
Well, first of all, it's not what happens in ADS-CFT.
That is circular. They came up with that because they believe deeply in unitarity.
I mean, well, this is the case. This is where we've been able to understand non-perturbative quantum gravity. And, I mean, you know, the challenge to you is to find a description which is as beautifully fleshed out and self-consistent as ADS-CFT, in which there's information loss. It's a very good project. I'm very sympathetic to the goal of trying to understand how to incorporate information loss into a description of fundamental physics. And in fact, I've spent a lot of time thinking about that problem myself. But so far, there really isn't a satisfactory candidate for a fundamental theory which incorporates intrinsic information loss. It always seems to lead to problems. For example, very gross and easily experimentally observable violations of conservation of energy.
Okay, so in ADS-CFT, okay, so one possible solution is that information is conserved as long as the metric of space-time does not change. So the question is, does the ADS-CFT evidence that information is conserved, and the ADS-CFT, does the metric of space-time change?
Sorry, the what of space-time changes?
So there's a curvature of space-time.
Right.
So there's some metric.
Yeah.
So it certainly is completely consistent with everything that information is not destroyed as long as the metric for space-time does not change. So is the evidence from ADS-CFT that information is conserved, does it include cases where the metric changes or not?
Well, I'm not sure I understand the question, but I think we can say this, that ADS-CFT sort of ties down the physics at the boundary of the space-time. It applies to geometries that are asymptotically anti de Sitter, but it allows the quantum fluctuations in the interior of the space-time to do anything they damn please. So there can be fluctuations which change the topology of the space-time and stuff like that going on. And yet, if there really is a CFT description which is exactly equivalent, then there doesn't seem to be a mechanism for information loss.
Okay. A lot of people like the Bekenstein bound because it might tell us something about quantum gravity or it might tell us something about physics. If you reduce it to just positive relative entropy, if you replace it with just a mathematical identity, doesn't it kind of lose its power to tell us anything about the physical world?
So the question is, we thought there was something deep about the Bekenstein bound, and if it's just positivity of relative entropy, isn't that awfully disappointing? Well, there are two Bekenstein bounds, and I'm not sure which one you're asking about. And this causes great confusion, even to me. But the Bekenstein bound, which can be reduced to positivity or non-negativity of relative entropy, is a statement just about quantum field theory. The Bekenstein bound, which in its somewhat fancier covariant version is also called the Busso bound, is a statement about gravitational physics, which I think is a much deeper statement and which we still only have a partial understanding of its origins. And that says that there's a limit to how much information you can put in a region because of gravitational effects, namely how black holes will form if you try to stuff too much information in. But what I was talking about was just a statement about quantum field theory without gravity.
Okay, let's wrap up the end of lecture one, have some coffee cookies, and we'll return at 3:30 for lecture two from John. Let's thank John for a great first lecture.